Hello and welcome to another event in the series Cultural Encounters, Books That Have Made a Difference. I'm Mike Scott and I'm speaking to you from Oxford in the UK. In this series, we're bringing together scholars and their audiences in order to explore themes of encounter in literary works and contemporary cultural debates. And today we welcome Professor Michael Collins talking about the dead by James Joyce. Michael J. Collins is Professor of English and Dean Emeritus at Georgetown University and an Honorary Fellow of Wrexham University in Wales. He is editor with Francis Ambrosio of Text and Teaching, The Search for Human Excellence, and with me, Mike Scott, of Christian Shakespeare Question Mark and its sequel, The Christian Literary Imagination, which is, really happy to say, to be published later this year. He has taught modern British literature at Georgetown and elsewhere around the world, and has published widely on modern British poets and playwrights. He received the Burn Award for Outstanding Teaching from Georgetown College. I've known Mike since 1987, when he invited me to come to Georgetown to teach on his summer school and Shakespeare. We've been friends ever since, often joining each other in classes of teaching and in publications and symposia and conferences. Mike is a great teacher, scholar, and friend. And I have to say, I've learned a lot from him during my career, and I thank him for that. If you have any questions during this talk, please type them in using the Q&A button, not the chat button, the Q&A button. Towards the end, I will put these questions to Mike and for him to answer and to carry on the conversation. Please don't leave your questions to the last minute, as we might run out of time and also we get a bottleneck at the end. So I'm looking forward to hearing Mike on the dead. He hasn't told me what he's going to say, so I'm looking forward to it. Over to you, Mike.
Thank you very much, Michael, for that very generous introduction. It's something I'm going to have to live up to, I'm afraid, this morning or this afternoon. But I'll try anyway to do a good job. The Dead is the concluding story to James Joyce's The Dubliners. It was written last in 1907, and it's the longest story in the collection. It is widely regarded as a masterpiece, one of the finest short stories in the English language. It reflects in a unique way the Irish literary revival of the 1890s and early 1900s. The Irish literary revival drew its inspiration from the myths and folklore of the past, from the indigenous Irish culture that continued to play a vital role in the lives of the common people who lived in the west of Ireland. While many writers, artists, and scholars were engaged in the effort to reclaim and revitalize this ancient culture, to recover the myths, stories, legends, the folklore still extant in the West, the figures we most immediately associate with it are William Butler Yeats, John Millington Synge, and Lady Augusta Gregory. Yeats wrote and published poems like The Wanderings of Oisín that drew on the ancient Irish myths and legends. Synge visited the Aran Islands off the western coast of Ireland each year for 6 summers, beginning in 1898, and published his book, The Aran Islands, in 1907, the same year as his play, The Playboy of the Western World, set in County Mayo in the West, was produced at the Abbey Theatre. Lady Gregory collected stories, ballads, folk tales from the area around her home at Coole Park and published several volumes of folklore. An ancient Irish culture survived among the provincial inhabitants of the West, a cultural tradition that many believed might provide a foundation upon which the Irish could forge a sense of identity and build a unified and independent nation. The West, as we shall see, takes on great metaphorical resonance in The Dead. The Dead begins in the home of Kate and Julia Morcan and their niece Mary Jane on the evening of their annual Christmas dinner dance. The story focuses on one of the guests, Gabriel Conway, Kate and Julia's nephew. Gabriel is accompanied by his wife, Greta, who comes to play a significant role at the end of the story. Gabriel's a teacher and a journalist who reviews books for the Daily Express, a unionist newspaper. As Joyce makes clear with a comic vignette early in the story, Gabriel's cultural commitments are not to Ireland, but to Europe, to the modern cosmopolitan world to the east. When Greta tells his aunts that her husband makes her wear galoshes, she adds that Gabriel says everyone wears them on the continent. Aunt Julia replies with sly sarcasm, "Oh, on the continent." The galoshes will take on greater resonance as the story comes to an end. The iron rod that runs through the dead is Gabriel's encounter with three women on the evening of the dinner dance. All three are personal encounters, but they are cultural encounters as well. The first is with Lily, the caretaker's daughter. Initially, Lily mispronounces Gabriel's name, adding a middle syllable, Conroy, and thus gives it a West Country pronunciation, which Gabriel smiles at. Gabriel's subsequent question to Lily about her young man leads to a bitter reply. "The man that is now is only palaver, and what they can get out of you." Her words, which we seem meant to remember later in the story, somehow embarrass or discomfort Gabriel, and he gives her a coin in an attempt to restore the lighthearted question of his tone. Sorry, the lighthearted tone of his question. While Gabriel's encounter with Lily reflects their difference in class, it also points to the cultural difference between Dublin and the West. This second difference will be more pronounced in Gabriel's next encounter with Miss Ivors. Molly Ivors is one of Gabriel's classmates at school and is now his colleague. She accuses him of being a West Briton, an Irishman sympathetic to the British, because he writes reviews for the Daily Express, a unionist newspaper. While Miss Ivors seems only to be teasing him, Gabriel takes offense at her remarks and is angered by them. He wants to say that literature is above politics. Miss Ivors then invites Gabriel to join her on an excursion in the summer to the west of Ireland, to the Aran Islands, but he explains that he has already made plans to visit France and Belgium. When Miss Ivors asks him, "Haven't you your own land to visit?" Gabriel tells her, "I am sick of my own country." During their talk of visiting the West, Miss Ivors reminds Gabriel that his wife is from Connacht, a province in the West, but he responds evasively, "Her people are." At the very moment when Yeats, Synge, and Lady Gregory are working to reestablish the lost relationship with the cultural traditions of Ireland, with the culture of the West, Gabriel rejects such efforts and commits himself to a European, or as we might put it today, a global culture. When Gabriel tells his wife about his conversation with Miss Ivors, she says, "Oh, I'd love to see Galway again." Gabriel replies coldly, You can go if you like." The tension between East and West, between European culture, represented in Ireland largely by its British variant, and the traditional Irish culture, was pointed out, for example, in 1892 by Douglas High, the founder of the Gaelic League, in his famous address on the necessity for de-Anglicizing the Irish nation. Here's Douglas High. "When we speak of the necessity for de-Anglicizing the Irish nation, we mean it not as a protest against imitating what is best in the Irish people, for that would be absurd, but rather to show the folly of neglecting what is Irish and hastening to adopt pell-mell and indiscriminately everything that is English. I appeal to everyone to do his best to help the Irish race to develop in future upon Irish lines." even at the risk of encouraging national aspirations, because upon Irish lines alone can the Irish race once more become what it was of yore, one of the most original, artistic, literary, and charming peoples of Europe. In 1907, the year The Dead was written and Sings Aran Islands was published, ordinary men and women like Molly Ivors were also trying to revitalize the traditional culture of their native land, a culture that remained integral to the lives of Irish people in the west of the country, to revitalize it in order to bring about a culturally and politically independent Ireland. In his encyclical letter, Fratelli Tutti, Pope Francis pointed out that an innate tension exists between globalization and localization. We need to pay attention to the global, he said, so as to avoid narrowness and banality. Yet we also need to look at the local, which keeps our feet on the ground. Universal fraternity, the global, and social friendship, the local, are thus two inseparable and equally vital poles in every society. To separate them would be to disfigure each and to create a dangerous polarity. But that seems to be precisely what Gabriel has done. By rejecting the local, the cultural traditions of his native land, and embracing the global, the European world to the east, he has created in himself the dangerous polarization which Pope Francis identifies. His insecurities, his defensiveness with Lily and with Miss Ivors seem to result from his rootlessness, from his being, as Pope Francis puts it, caught up in an abstract, globalized universe. From being an alien in his own country and, paradoxically, an alien in the global world he has chosen to be his home, Gabriel remains a stranger in his own country and in the European countries he visits. Pope Francis goes on to point out that just as there can be no dialogue with others without a sense of our own identity, so there can be no openness between peoples except on the basis of love for one's own land, one's own people, one's own cultural roots. The Pope has spoken frequently about creating a culture of encounter, a culture that enables persons to meet one another openly and sympathetically, to engage in dialogue with attention to and respect for the other person. Gabriel, it seems, is unable to engage in a genuine dialogue with either Lily or Miss Ivors because he is not at home, either in the cosmopolitan culture to which he has committed himself, nor in the culture of his native land. He is uprooted. He has no place to stand. Aunt Kate and Aunt Julia have engaged Gabriel to give a speech at dinner. He worries about it as the time approaches, fearing his quotation of a poem by Browning might be beyond the understanding of the audience. But then, quote, an idea came into his mind and gave him courage. He would say, alluding to Aunt Kate and Aunt Julia, ladies and gentlemen, the generation which is now on the wane among us may have had its faults, but for my part, I think it had certain qualities of hospitality, of humor, of humanity, which the new and very serious and hyper-educated generation that is growing up around us now seems to me to lack. His decision to celebrate the traditions of the past, however, turns out to be an insincere and cynical attempt to insult Miss Ivors. Very good. That was one for Miss Ivors. What did he care? That is, as I'm quoting now from the story, what did he care that his aunts were only two old, ignorant women? Gabriel, himself one of the hyper-educated generation, rejects, even ridicules, the traditions he pretends to value and denigrates his aunts because they are uneducated and, despite living in Dublin, provincial. But Miss Ivors leaves the dinner before his speech and Gabriel fails to have his petty revenge. As the guests gather by the door to leave, Gabriel notices his wife standing motionless on the staircase, listening to Bartle Darcy singing The Lass of Aghrim in a room upstairs. It is a tragic ballad from the West about a woman who is betrayed by the father of her child and rejected as she stands with the child in her arms outside his house in the rain. Gabriel, surprised at her stillness, responds to the moment as one might respond to a painting. He thinks of Greta as a symbol of something and imagines, if he were to paint her at that moment, the dark panels of her skirt would show off the light ones. He would call the painting, he thinks, distant music. He seems unable to think of his wife as an actual living woman listening to music. But Greta's response to the music is different from Gabriel's response to her. It is not the confluence of words and notes, the harmonies of the piece, its artfulness that engages her, but rather, as we shall learn, it is the memories that drift in on the music from the past, from the West, and take her back to her youth in Galway. When Greta and Gabriel are settled in the Gresham Hotel, where they will spend the night, Gabriel hopes to make love to his wife. But Greta seems distant, preoccupied, and does not respond to Gabriel's overtures. It is here, with Gabriel's mendacious speech at dinner and the fever and rage of desire he now feels for Greta, that we seem meant to recall Lily's words, "The man that is now is only palaver and what they can get out of you." And then slowly Greta tells Gabriel that the song she listened to so intently on the stairs, The Lass of Aghrim, was sung to her by a boy, Michael Fury, with whom she knew when she was a young girl in Galway. "He was in the gasworks," she tells Gabriel. "I was great with him at the time." Gabriel remembers that Greta was excited earlier in the evening at the prospect of going to Galway in the summer, and he snidely asks her if it was because she wanted to see Michael Fury again. Greta tells him, "Michael Fury is dead." When Gabriel asks her how he died, Greta responds, "I think he died for me." On the night before, Greta was to leave Galway and come to the convent in Dublin. Michael Fury, grievously ill, appeared in her garden in the rain. Greta came down from her room, and they stood together behind the house while the rain continued to fall. When Greta told him, quote, he would get his death in the rain, he said he did not want to live. A week later, Greta, in Dublin, heard that he was dead. The differences between Gabriel and Michael Fury are inescapable. Gabriel is cosmopolitan, well-educated, able to quote Shakespeare and Browning, but cut off from his own culture and heritage, protected from the snow in Dublin with his galoshes. Michael Fury is provincial, poorly educated, employed in the gasworks, but, as the song he sings to Greta suggests, rooted in a cultural tradition, capable, as he stands outside of Greta's window in the rain, of a romantic gesture that recalls the heroic myths and tragic ballads of the past. And in their differences, Joyce has illuminated the tension between the global and the local in his own time, as well as in ours. Gabriel and Michael Fury live in two different worlds and are committed to two different cultures. And while the story finds Michael Fury a more attractive figure than the pretentious and at times mean-spirited Gabriel, it does not deny that each of them is, as Pope Francis might put it, disfigured by their cultural isolation. For neither has access to the fullness of the world. Both the global and the local are, in the words of Pope Francis, two inseparable and equally vital poles in every society, and I add, and in every person. The third cultural encounter in the story, however, is not between Gabriel and the ghost of Michael Fury, but between Gabriel and his wife. In the hotel, Greta gradually reveals the story of her youthful love affair with Michael Fury, a story that is rooted in the country, in the provincial culture of Galway, and recalls, with its reference to the Lass of Aughrim, the folk tales and traditional tragic ballads that remained a vital part of that culture. Gabriel's initially disdainful and sarcastic, but then, as Greta goes on to tell her story, he listens quietly and responds sympathetically to her. Here is the one genuine encounter in the story. Gabriel, at this moment, no longer thinks of Greta simply as his wife, or as the object of his desire, or as a provincial girl from the country, or as the subject of a painting. Greta allows herself to be wholly known, and Gabriel sees her, perhaps for the first time, as a person to whose story he must attend with compassion and respect. This moment of the dead seems to present the kind of human engagement Pope Francis imagines when he speaks of a culture of encounter. Although Gabriel discovers that his wife once loved another man and was loved by him in a way he himself, that is Gabriel, might never be capable of emulating, Gabriel nonetheless looks at Greta as she sleeps, unresentfully, and is later filled with generous tears, as the story says, as he lies next to her on their bed. Gabriel has entered sympathetically into Greta's story and into the culture that shaped it as well. We may wonder what their marriage will be like now that Gabriel has drawn him into her for the first time, has drawn him into her world. As the story grows to a close, Gabriel watches the snow falling outside the window of the hotel. The time has come, I'm quoting the story now, he thinks, to set out on his journey westward. While it's not entirely clear what those words mean, they may suggest that Gabriel now sees the need to root himself in his native land, to embrace, as Pope Francis puts it, the local and the enrichment that it brings. But at the same time, as Gabriel imagines the snow falling all over Ireland, the conclusion of the story foresees, perhaps, the obliteration of the local, the gradual erosion of the indigenous cultures and traditions. As the snow covers the land with a leveling blanket of white, hiding the various features that enrich it, so the pull of globalization may put an end not just to the distinctive Irish culture that Gabriel seems at last to have come to value, but to all the many cultures that create together the rich multiplicity of our world. It is Nobel lecture, the Irish poet, Seamus Heaney, told a story out of Ireland, the legendary Christian story of St. Kevin and the Blackbird, a story rooted in the ancient culture of Ireland. According to the legend, a blackbird mistook St. Kevin's arms, extended in prayer, for the branches of a tree, and built her nest in his hand. Kevin remained with his arms outstretched until the bird's eggs had hatched and the fledglings flown away. Another kind of cultural encounter. Such stories, Heaney proposed, function as bearers of value. Even if we have learned, he said, to be rightly and deeply fearful of elevating the cultural forms and conservatisms of any nation into normative and exclusivist systems, even if we have terrible proof that pride in an ethnic and religious heritage can quickly degrade into the fascistic, our vigilance on that score should not displace our love and trust in the good of the indigenous per se. On the contrary, our trust in the staying power and travel worthiness of such good should encourage us to credit the possibility of a world where respect for the validity of every tradition will issue in the creation and maintenance of a salubrious political space. In Tutti Fratelli, Pope Francis has called for the growth of a culture of encounter capable of transcending our differences and divisions, a culture in which men and women might enter with sympathy and respect into the worldview of another. At the same time, Francis reminds us that there can be no openness between people except on the basis of love for one's own land, one's own people, one's own cultural roots. The dead, I propose, through Gabriel's three cultural encounters, anticipates not just the tension we experience in the modern world between the global and the local, but the distrust or disdain we sometimes feel for the many local cultures that enrich the global world in which we live. Yet finally, through Gabriel's encounter with Greta in the hotel room, the dead affirms, as does Pope Francis, the need for openness, for love and trust in the good of the indigenous, if we are to have genuine and meaningful encounters between people and nations. Thank you.
Mike, thank you very much. That's a fabulous talk, and thoroughly enjoyed that. I want to go first to Molly Clark, who says this. Thank you for a beautiful talk. The words from Pope Francis are very moving. How do you think literature in general can help us join together the global and the local?
Well, I take that maybe back a step to something that seems to us more familiar. When we enter into the creative world of a piece of literature, we enter into it imaginatively. We enter into that world and try, and it enables us, if you like, to imagine the other, as we put it these days, to see another world and people, the people who inhabit that world. And ordinarily, it asks us to see them, not just to imagine them, but to see them with, to use my own words there, with sympathy and respect. And so, I read the dead and I try to imagine what life, what that world was like. I using Joyce's words, I try to understand the people in it, not to be too harsh in my judgment of Gabriel, who comes around, I think, in the end. But through literature, it is through the power of our imagination that is triggered by the literature we read, we come to see and understand and to respond with sympathy to other people, other cultures.
Thanks, Mike. Richard Wagerman says, why does literary theory so often downplay connections between works of fiction and their authors? Yet biographical reductionism is a mistake. But in The Dead, I learned from Terence Brown's notes in the Penguin edition, there is a fascinating, abundant evidence that Joyce based Michael Fury on Michael Budkin, Nora's Galway sweetheart. For me, that part of the story is especially moving, presumably due to his empathy for Nora.
Well, I will now be driven out of the profession when I say this, but it seems to me that idea of the absent author, that the story is ultimately the result not of the intention of the author, but by a variety of cultural forces impinging upon the author, seems to me to it's to try to be an overcorrection of something that sees everything that's written by an author as somehow biographical. So, as I said, it seems to me that the death of the author is an attempt to it's an overcorrection of the other side of that coin, which says that everything the author writes is ultimately biographical. That's a great question with Shakespeare. We think if we knew more about Shakespeare, we might know more about the plays. I'm not sure that at all that is all true. But there are many people who believe, the more you know about Shakespeare, the more you can know about the plays. On the other hand, to say, it doesn't matter. The fact that Shakespeare had a son named Hamnet, who died shortly before he wrote Hamlet, there may be a connection there that might be interesting and significant if we knew something about it. So on the one hand, I think what you have to do is to try to judiciously think about the biography. And I think you're absolutely right. From what I have read, Nora did have a love affair with a man in Galway, a young man in Galway, before she became Dublin, who died. And Joyce actually went, if we're talking about the same person, but one of them anyway, that one of the friends of Nora in Galway had Joyce went and visited his grave. So somehow Joyce's experience as a person was transformed through the power of the imagination, as we say, was transformed into the story of the dead. The one thing to recognize, of course, is, as I hope my paper suggested, that the transformation of the story, the transformation of the biography into the story makes the story meaningful. The biography is just a series of events in the life of the writer.
Thanks for that, Mike. Harry Blumeyer's writes, and it just carries on from that discussion, really. But Harry Blumeyer writes that Joyce's work unites intimate projection of self with distanced judgment upon self. And it unites intimate projection of Dublin with a distanced judgment upon it. The artist offers up his city as well as himself, that the reader may enter upon an epiphany.
That's said very well, and I don't know what I would have to say in response. I've been trying to relearn some of the things I knew about Joyce as I was preparing for this, and of course the dead is rather different from the other stories in Dubliners. It seems to be more sympathetic toward the people, or the people that inhabit the story are more sympathetic than they would be. If you see Gabriel as a figure for Joyce himself, then yes, he kind of enters into the story, and yet there is kind of an overarching vision that shapes the story and gives it the meaning, or if you like, the meanings that it seems to have. I'm not sure I've really done much to advance what you've already said.
I think Blumeyer is actually talking about the encounter of one and the other results in an epiphany, basically, through a beautiful story.
I mean, that Joyce's use of the epiphany, that moment in that, it seems to me, the moment that Greta says, I think he died for me. That is the epiphanic moment, I think, in the story.
Yeah.
I think he died.
It's quite moving.
Quite moving. And it all, boom, it all, I think, I probably can't find it quickly enough, but I think the response that Joyce writes for If I can just grab it quickly. Of course, I also grabbed the one with the small print, which makes things even more difficult. Where I think she says, I think he died for me. And here's what Joyce writes next. A vague terror seized Gabriel at this answer, as if at that hour when he had hoped to triumph, that is to make love to his wife, some impalpable and vindictive being was coming against him, gathering forces against him in its vague world. That moment of terror, that's the epiphanic moment, the epiphany.
Carol Gobishki says, thanks for a wonderful talk. We can live with those we are closest to as strangers, in this case, Gabriel to his wife. It is the wife's confession that opens his heart. Is the danger of a globalization without being rooted in the global a symptom of the loss of confessional practice?
Let me have the last, being rooted in the global?
Is the danger of a globalization without being rooted in the global a symptom of the loss of confessional practices?
If I understand the question, yes, in this sense that there was a wonderful book written some time ago by a man named Thomas Friedman, who's a journalist for the New York Times and lives just up the road from where I am now, called The Lexus and the Olive Tree. And he used the Lexus and the Olive Tree as symbols, the Lexus of the global world in which we all are in some way part of, and the Olive Tree, the local world, the Olive Tree planted by a man's grandfather or great-grandfather and as kind of a symbol of the local and traditional culture. Friedman's argument was that there's a tension there, but that both are necessary. I mean, the global is inescapable. We have to, and the Pope says the same thing, we have to be part of the global. Inevitably, we're part of the global. We wouldn't have the shoes on our feet if we weren't part of the global world. The Pope says, you must be recognize the universal so as not to become provincial. But on the other hand, you need to be rooted in something in order to live well in the world, to be grounded somewhere. And Seamus Heaney, I think, making the same point. The local, the stories, like the story of Kevin the Blackbird, it is a bearer of value. It carries with it normative principles. It's told in story form, as many of these locally grounded stories do. Heaney recognizes, of course, the danger of such local rootedness. In 1027, King seeing Olaf III defeated so and so at the Battle of the Bridge, and we remember that, and we were forever at enmity with our neighbors. That's the danger of it. But on the other hand, these things provide value. They tell us who we are. They define us. They give us something that we can believe in. All that is necessary to counterbalance the leveling, or maybe that's not the universalizing that the global brings with it. Friedman's book is wonderful about the Lexus and the Olive Tree. It's a very long book. It's not a terribly long book, but he teases that out for many pages. But that basic insight of Lexus and Olive Tree, the universal and the local. You that metaphor reflects many different tensions in the world we live in now.
Is it to do with the identity of the person? The very identity?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you have to, you have to be, it seems to me, rooted somewhere. Now, you can, I guess you can have a multiplicity of roots. What I always say is, that my olive tree was planted in the Bronx. Everything I ever learned that was important, I learned in the Bronx, at the place I grew up. There was a distinct culture there, and in some ways you become rooted in that culture, to quote Hemingway, wherever you go for the rest of your life, it stays with you. Because that culture is in some way a movable feast, some richness that goes with you throughout your life.
I can't remember from the story. Gabriel, does he actually come from Dublin?
It's never clear.
I didn't think, no.
It's not clear. I don't think he does, but there's something about his mother commenting on Greta as being, and it annoys him, country cute. So
that's right.
They are Easterners, yes, in some way. They're urban or suburban, I would, in our terms. I don't remember that it's made particularly clear. If you went back and checked it and looked at it. I looked at the geography, knew the geography better than I do, you might be able to answer that question.
Yeah, but I think country cute, actually, I remember that phrase now.
That annoys me. Also, I like the idea when Miss Ivor says, well, your wife's from Connaught, isn't she? And he says, well, her people are. Admit that his wife comes from Galway. Yes. And then, of course, if you see the movie, The Dead, what's her name? Angelica Houston plays Greta, and she's so beautiful and attractive in that film. You say, well, poor Gabriel, he just is so, I don't know what it is. He just doesn't see it. He wants to be cosmopolitan. He wants to be sophisticated and educated, and he just can't handle it.
But the last shot in that film, I think, is him staring out the window and seeing the snow covering everything.
If you've never, I say this to who's ever listening, if you've never seen the film, track it down. It's a faithful rendering of the film. And it's and it, as of sorry of the story,
the story.
And it is also in its own right a very fine film. John Huston is the director, and his daughter plays Greta.
Colin. Colin Parsons says, "I enjoyed this very much, Mike. Thanks. I'm wondering about your characterization of Gabriel's tears at the end as generous. Indeed, Joyce does use the word, but it is a word that Gabriel uses about himself repeatedly, and a somewhat more cynical reading would suggest that Gabriel hasn't really had the transformation at the end that he wishes for himself. Is there a way of reading this in which the cultural encounter is desired by being unachieved, or perhaps I'm too harsh on Gabriel? It's desired but unachieved.
Colleen, you're too harsh on Gabriel. Yes, of course. That ending, as you know, we all know, is very ambiguous. I read it. Generous tears as he lies on the bed. I read them as just what as not ironic or cynical, but actually that he had come to some understanding not just of Greta, but in some way, Greta's story is embedded in the culture in which it occurred. And he, that is, you know, he sees something even more largely than Greta's story. He sees something about the world in which that story took place. Now, I have sitting on my desk here, you know, a collection of critical essays, and not everybody obviously agrees. You're right, not everybody agrees with the ending. And it was left, Joyce is at least as smart as you and I are. And I guess he left it that way deliberately to leave open the question, what really happens to Gabriel as a result of his encounter with Greta? Is he just sort of, what would be the word, flattering himself with his sensitivity in the same way he has been flattering himself throughout the story?
Yes, it's the same as the snow, whether the snow covers everything,
yeah.
including Michael Fury and everything,
or
whether it unites everything.
Yes.
You know, one or the other.
Yeah.
But isn't that the
And also, the question is, well, another way to put the question is, the snow doing a good thing?
Yeah.
Or a bad thing?
Precisely.
I read it as doing a bad thing, but to put it simply, it's obliterating and leveling everything out. But you might read it another way.
What I like about this is Colin and yourself both in the same English department, and you've got a cultural encounter there in terms of literary criticism, That's, ladies and gentlemen, is what literature is about, what literary criticism is about, and is why people should go and read it at university. Yeah, let me just get that in, because a lot of people are stopping reading it, and we ought to get people reading literature, and then we might start to find some of the cultural encounters in the world that aren't happening might happen again. Sorry, Mike.
Yeah, no, the real issue is not whether I'm right or Colleen is right,
correct,
but rather in that ambiguity that we see in the type, we get to enter into the human questions that the story raises. To go back to Molly Clark's question, we imaginatively enter into that world. We read it in different ways. We recognize the inevitable ambiguity of all human enterprise, and that at least, however, sensitizes us to the to the world in which we live.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mike, can I just take you back to some other area that you didn't talk about very much, but is quite prominent within the story, and that is the opera. You know, you get the idea, well, there is the opera and Caruso, and I'm sure one of the characters says, I'd love to hear Caruso sing, and so on and so forth. And then you get the character whose voice is going, but still in the end does sing. What's the function of music, do you think, within the story, I think
the most fundamental level, the opera is Browning and Shakespeare. The Lass of Aghrim is the West and the folk traditions, and so there's another contrast there between the European music, complex and cosmopolitan music of Europe, versus the folk music, the ballad of the West. To be honest, I probably should have given more thought to that, but I did not. But it seems to me that it's the same idea. And there's an interesting moment there where Mary Jane plays the piano. Mary Jane, the niece, is a very good piano player. You know, she teaches piano. She has students and so on. And she does this, I can't remember what it, you know, that a piece of music that is technically challenging. But it's all technique, you know, and I can't remember the precise what Gabriel calls it. But Gabriel doesn't want to listen to that.
No.
Yeah, he doesn't want to listen to that. He said he doesn't like listening to that, just the music, music, music. And to be honest, I'm not sure what to make of that, but you're right. All of this stuff about music, the teachers and so on, and then there's the silencing of Aunt Julia, I think it is, who sings in the choir, and the church decides that no more women in the choir, and so
And
she
that's the
can't sing
Pope's
anymore.
fault. It's the
But
Pope's fault. It's
that's
the
the Pope's
Pope's
fault.
fault.
Yeah, the Pope's fault. And so there is, as you say, much about music. In some ways, you can see it as, the same tension as that as the other tension, the local and the universal that's playing through the story. It's interesting that Bartle D'Arcy doesn't sing the opera, but sings The Lass of Aughrim, and sings it with a hoarse note. But maybe Colleen can help me on that one. I don't know. I mean, I don't have anything much to say about that in terms of interpretation.
I noticed that Gabriel says he knew it was coming to an end because she goes into as she'd started with going up and down the scales almost, and that's how, so he knew it was going to end
So
then,
there's something that,
totally dismissed.
that it seems like not quite what Gabriel would, but it seems what Gabriel would like would be this proficiency of technique, but he doesn't like it. And so maybe but I don't really know. I don't want to sound, give some kind of an ingenious or disingenuous interpretation.
Yes. There's an interesting local reference here with Shannon Mulligan, who's says many thanks as always, so much gratitude for these Zooms. Not a question, but too good not to share. And he says that how does this re relate? And doesn't apologize for the fact that the eagles will come and tear out his eyes. An island as the sow that eats its own farrow. Is this a reference to something that was happening yesterday? The master, the local with the weight of the global, Stephen D under the table, hearing that it doesn't apologize. The eagles will come and tear out his eyes. An island as the sow will that eats its own farrow.
What's
No. I'm not too sure what that is, Shannon. I thought it might have been relating to the American football match last night, but
I don't know.
no. Okay,
Can we get some help? No.
yeah. If you can clarify that, Shannon, clarify it, will you please? Thanks very much. Yeah. Okay. Let me just have a look. Yes, and the other thing I wondered about, Mike, is not just the music, but the dance. And it's a waltz, isn't it? They talk about the waltz that's going on, and it's next door, the waltz. It's behind the door. They can hear at one moment they can hear the clothes even touching the wall. But what's going on there, do you think?
They're dancing. Well, again, that the one might argue that one might argue that the dance is in some ways what these two people moving as one when they're waltzing is the kind of sympathetic engagement that Gabriel has been unable to achieve in his talks, in his encounter with Miss Ivors or Lily, the caretaker's daughter. When Gabriel and Miss Ivors are dancing, it's a kind of a conflict. They pass one, they exchange little snide comments at one another as they trace around the dance floor. Whereas later, the dance becomes something more that the conflict is out of the dance, and it's now you have the sense that people are moving in harmony one to the other. But again, I'm not sure that you want to read too much into that. It may also be simply to kind of create the atmosphere in which the dinner takes place.
Yeah. Colin comes to our help on this on the last one.
Good.
He says those quotes are from a portrait of the artist, young man. But it's a long time since I've read that, Colin. So thanks for referring us to that.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we're almost coming to an end. I just say on a personal kind of level that as I've said before, if my name wasn't Michael Scott, it would be Michael O'Reilly. Because my mother was Nora O'Reilly, my grandfather was Fergus O'Reilly. So whenever I read The Dead, and I read it periodically, so one of those short stories you go back to, it reminds me actually of the Christmases that I had as a little boy. You know, I mean, we didn't have the dance, but we had the music and we had the characters, the O'Reillys and the Reillys and the Kernans, so all meeting together. And I always find it a rather comforting book, to be honest, rather than a challenging book. And I do find myself, the snow is rather comforting at the end. We've worked through it, and you've got that. But I can understand the other way as well, the other reading. Mike, thanks. I don't think there are any more questions that have come in. Thank you very much for a terrific lecture. And everybody who's been writing in is just saying thank you so much for a great lecture. Okay, I need to just go and give some announcements now. I hope everybody that you'll join us for the next one, which will be the last one for this term, but it'll be on the 26th of February. Not next week, because I understand it's President's Day next week. So it's going to be on the 26th of February. And we'll be having here Dr. Alexa Alice Jobin from the George Washington University down in DC, talking about worldwide encounters with Shakespeare. And you might know her work. She's got a great work about Shakespeare and the East, and the development and the productions of Shakespeare in the East. Well, she's going to be talking about worldwide encounters with Shakespeare. We have an interesting talk in our free speech and the international at the crossroads coming up on Wednesday, February the 14th, St. Valentine's Day, when we will be asking how the world might change with so many important and unpredictable elections this year. Half the world seems to be going to the elections this year, and televisions are always on about it. Not just about the US election. There's one in the UK, there's one in Europe, there are elections in Africa, there's an election in China, there are elections right around the world. So this time next year, it might be a very, very different world. Can I thank the Georgetown Humanities Initiative for our funding for these series? Also thank individuals, Jack DeJoy, the President, the Vice President of Global Affairs, Tom Banshaft, and thanks to Julia Murillo and Mary Gordon. And thanks to Mike, not just for today's lecture, but for the support he gives me in developing this series. I'd also like to thank at Blackfriars Hall the support of John O'Connor, the Regent, and Richard Finn, the Director of the Las Casas Institute. And of course, my thanks to Maggie Scott, my wife, who's helps in the administration of all of this. I'm Mike Scott. I'm from Blackfriars Hall in Oxford. You can follow me on LinkedIn at Professor Michael Scott or on Facebook as Michael Kerr Scott. Thanks for joining us. Thanks again, Mike. Goodbye, everybody.